Tag TV brings you daily news bulletin from India. Breaking news and views from India.
Good evening. Welcome to South Asia Newsline. I'm Yeshi Chonzom. Here are the top stories we are tracking for you on Monday, the 7th of September. India reopens metro trains while COVID-19 cases cross 4.2 million mark. Taliban appoints new chief negotiator ahead of intra-Afghan talks. And their toll rises to 26 in Bangladesh mosque gas pipeline blast. And now for all the details. India's COVID-19 cases tally rose to over 4.2 million, overtaking Brazil as the country with the second highest recorded cases. As the pandemic continues its surge, Indian government partially resumed metro train services in different cities across the country on Monday after a gap of more than 5 months.
Metro services resumed on Monday morning in different cities across India after a gap of more than 5 months, even as coronavirus cases reached 4.2 million. Metro services resumed in southern Chennai and Hyderabad cities along with northern Gurugram and Noida, with measures being taken to prevent the spread of coronavirus. However, Maharashtra, the most affected state, will not be resuming the metro operation this month. Commuters were sparse as New Delhi resumed metro rail services after a break of more than 5 months, with stations nearly deserted. Delhi Metro will operate in two shifts and normal operations will start from 12th of September.
We are going to duty, we are very depressed, we are very good. How are you
going
to go before this? We are going to go, sometimes motorcycle, sometimes something.
India displaced Brazil on Monday to take second place in terms of coronavirus infections with 90,082 new cases. There are 882,542 active cases of the infection in the country, which comprises 20.99% of the total case load.
We are happy with the arrangement made by the Chennai Metro and the sanitization also being done. And personal hygiene are also be taken care. And I think people should come forward and take care and stay safe during traveling.
Meanwhile, the Indian government has said that its rising infections also reflect high rates of testing nationwide. And the high recovery rates show its strategy of testing, tracing and treatment is working. And the situation is under control in a country of its size.
Moving on, Baloch activists held a demonstration in Germany's Hamburg city recently over the killing of Hayat Mirza Baloch, a Karachi University student, by Pakistan's Frontier Corps. The incident has once again highlighted the issue of ongoing human rights violations by Pakistani security forces in Balochistan.
The Free Balochistan Movement organized a demonstration and a protest rally in Germany's Hamburg city against the killing of Hayat Mirza Baloch, a Karachi University student, by Pakistani security forces in Balochistan region. The protesters held banners and placards demanding justice for Hayat Baloch and highlighted atrocities on indigenous people in Balochistan since the construction of projects as part of the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor. Hayat Mirza Baloch was picked up from an orchard in Balochistan's Turbat and shot dead in front of his father in cold blood by Pakistan's paramilitary Frontier Corps on August 13 as they cordoned off the area post an attack on them by pro-freedom Baloch armed groups. Protests have continued in Balochistan and across the world to demand justice for him. The incident has once again highlighted the issue of ongoing human rights violations in the region. Activists have long accused that Pakistan Army has been carrying so-called military operations in the region for years with an aim to eliminate the Baloch people. They blame thousands have been internally displaced because of armed conflicts and army operations over the years.
ahead of the peace talks between the Afghan government and the Taliban set to begin in Doha this week, Taliban leadership has appointed a hardline cleric, Sheikh Abdul Hakim, as the group's key negotiator for the crucial talks.
The Taliban leadership has appointed hardline cleric Sheikh Abdul Hakim as head of their 21-member negotiating team in Qatar ahead of the Afghan peace talks. Taliban spokesman Zabiullah Mujahid in a Twitter post on Monday confirmed that Sheikh Maulbi Abdul Hakim was appointed head of negotiation team and Sher Mohammad Abbas Denikzai as his deputy. Taliban has also appointed Mohammad Naeem Wardak as a spokesman of their negotiating team. The changes in the Taliban's negotiating team come as the intra-Afghan negotiations between the Islamic Republic of Afghanistan and the Taliban are set to begin this week, aiming to put an end to two decades of war and the loss of thousands of lives in Afghanistan. Meanwhile, reports suggest that Afghan negotiators have pushed back a planned trip to Doha as logistical issues are still being worked on in Qatari capital.
In news from Sri Lanka, the fire on a large oil tanker off Sri Lanka's coast was completely extinguished on Sunday, 3 days after the incident was reported, the Sri Lankan Navy has said. The Navy, however, still remains on high alert as there was a possibility of a reoccurrence of the fire.
The fire on board an oil tanker off Sri Lanka's eastern waters was completely extinguished nearly 79 hours after the incident was reported, the Lankan Navy said on Sunday. However, the Navy remains on high alert as there is a possibility of reoccurrence of the fire in the empty New Diamond oil tanker. The Navy said due to the high temperature inside the ship and the environmental influences, the fire can restart and therefore the Navy is on high alert and is ready for any emergency. The Sri Lankan Navy will continue to provide assistance to the distressed ship until it leaves the Sri Lanka's maritime search and rescue region. Meanwhile, a team of salvage experts arrived in Sri Lanka on Sunday as they prepared to examine a strike in an abandoned supertanker off the coast. The salvage team was taken to a Sri Lankan Navy vessel to be transported to the ship, which is lying off some 25 miles off the country's east coast. The Sri Lankan government plans to launch a legal action to claim the cost of fighting the fire.
Moving on to news from Nepal. Nepal on Monday witnessed the highest number of recoveries from the coronavirus so far, with 1,814 COVID-19 patients getting discharged after successfully fighting the contagion. However, the country continues to register new virus cases affecting cultural and religious events.
Nepal on Monday witnessed the highest number of recoveries from the coronavirus so far, with 1,814 COVID-19 patients getting discharged after successfully fighting the contagion. With Monday's additions, the number of patients who have recovered from the deadly virus in the Himalayan nation stands at 28,941, showed data by Nepal's health ministry. Meanwhile, health authorities also diagnosed 980 new cases of COVID-19 on Monday, of which 354 are from Kathmandu Valley. As the country continues to register more number of coronavirus cases, cultural and religious events like Rato Machindranath Jatra is being celebrated with almost no extravaganza. Rato Machindranath Jatra is the longest chariot festival of the Himalayan nation. However, due to strict measures amid COVID-19, the festival was fast-tracked. A clash between local devotees and police last week over pulling of the Rato Machindranath chariot as part of the annual celebrations also left dozens injured and several were arrested. A day later, Kshama Puja or worship for forgiveness was performed, after which people from 19 various ethnic groups agreed to fast-track the chariot procession.
Moving on to news from Bangladesh. The death toll from a gas pipeline explosion in a mosque outside Bangladeshi capital Dhaka rose to at least 26 people, including a child, on Monday, while authorities are examining how a leakage caused the incident during evening prayers.
"26 people have so far died and several others suffered injuries from the explosion at the mosque outside Bangladesh's capital last week. Dozens of worshippers who were injured in the explosion when the prayers were about to end on Friday night at Paschim Tala Bait Salam Mosque in Narayanganj district, just outside the capital Dhaka, are currently receiving treatment in state-run specialized burn and plastic surgery hospital. Fire service officials suspect the explosion was caused by leakage from the pipeline. The case has been filed against the Mosque Management Committee, its construction authority, the Concerned Electricity and Titus Gas authorities, among others. Meanwhile, a writ petition has been filed with the High Court on Monday, seeking its order upon the authorities concerned of Titus Gas Limited to give 50 lakh taka or $58,888 in compensation to each family of victims who died and suffered injuries from the mosque blast.
Marking a milestone in India-Bangladesh ties, the two neighbouring countries operationalised a new riverine trade route this past weekend, with a Bangladeshi vessel transporting a cargo of cement to India's northeast Tripura state. The new protocol route aims to facilitate bilateral trade with improved reliability and cost effectiveness.
Operations on the India-Bangladesh inland waterway route officially began this past weekend with a Bangladeshi vessel transporting a cargo of cement from the neighbouring country's Mushiganj port to Sonamura port in India's northeastern Tripura state. Tripura Chief Minister Biplab Kumar Deb welcomed the vessel carrying the first ever export consignment from Bangladesh through the inland waterways on Saturday. He said the route has opened new horizons between the two countries. Vessels will travel on the River Gomti, which merges with River Meghna in Bangladesh, as part of the riverine trade route. A permanent jetty will be soon built in Sonamura for the loading and unloading of goods.
I hope India and Bangladesh both will generate ample opportunities for generation of income. So these opportunities and today's the river and trial run project will also play a greater role and importance role.
This comes as the protocol for inland water trade and transit signed in 1972 was further expanded by India and Bangladesh in May this year, with inclusion of additional routes and ports of calls. The new protocol route aims to facilitate the bilateral trade with improved reliability and cost effectiveness for the business community and the people of both the countries.
The transgender community in India's southern Chennai city is helping the government and local authorities in the battle against the coronavirus, from creating awareness to conducting door-to-door screening and coordinating ground-level efforts. Members of the transgender community have been at the front lines in many badly affected areas and congested slums across the city.
Members of the transgender community in Chennai city of India's southern Tamil Nadu state have taken it upon themselves to take the COVID-19 fight to the next level in the slums of the city. Transgender community members, armed with pamphlets, thermal scanners and recording books, head to the slum areas and raise awareness about social distancing, importance of mask and also record temperatures and pulses of the slum dwellers on behalf of the Chennai Municipal Corporation. Tamil Nadu has so far confirmed 463,480 coronavirus cases with at least 7,836 associated deaths. India's total coronavirus case surged beyond 4.2 million with a record rise on Monday, making it the second country in the world to surpass that mark, following the United States.
Well, that's all we have for you from South Asia this evening. Now our viewers can watch the show on southasianewsline.com. You can also visit us on facebook.com/AsiaNewsline and follow us on Twitter at AsiaNewsline. That's all in tonight's edition. We'll see you same time tomorrow. Good night.
Subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button. subscribe TAG TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.